Julia Child, welcome to my house. What fun we're going to have baking all kinds of incredible cakes, pies, and breads right here in my own kitchen. How does bread from a bread machine stack up against a handmade loaf? Lora Brody, our bread machine wizard, teaches us how to use this popular appliance to make everything from breadsticks to quitza. Join us on Baking with Julia. A house is not a home without a bread machine nowadays. And I have with me Lora Brody, who is the queen of the machine, and she has not only one, but two machines. Let's start in.
Well, to show the versatility of the bread machine, Julia, I'm going to make a loaf of white buttermilk bread. And it's important to measure the ingredients into the bread pan when it's out of the machine. You don't want to be spilling stuff on the coil. So I'm going to put in the dry ingredients first, starting with the yeast. And this recipe calls for 2.5 teaspoons of yeast. And I use the instant yeast. That is not the same as rapid rise. Instant means that it dissolves instantly in the bread mix.
Oh, because that's you need very much in the machine.
Exactly. And this is powdered buttermilk, which is available in the health food store. And we're going to use 3 tablespoons. Mm-hmm. And salt, we need 1 teaspoon of salt. You know, back to the yeast for a second, when you measure yeast, it's essentially to use a clean, dry teaspoon. And, you know, a lot of men use bread machines, and they think a teaspoon is something they think they invented baking. Right? Teaspoon is something you stir your coffee with. This is a teaspoon. Okay, we've got the salt. The next ingredient is the flour, which are 3 cups, and I am of the scoop and level method.
Good. I think that's the most accurate.
And I am using regular flour, unbleached and unbromated. If you want to use bread machine flour or better for bread flour, that's fine. Whatever works.
It's just plain all-purpose.
And we're going to use a table for the fat element. We're going to use 1 tablespoon of very soft butter. You can use salt or sweet as you wish. And 3 tablespoons of maple syrup.
Now, if you don't like sweet bread, can you omit the sugar?
Absolutely, you can omit the sugar. Yeah. However, you need the salt. Salt acts as a yeast retardant, so the bread doesn't blow up out of the machine.
And if you wanted, you could use honey rather than maple syrup.
Brown sugar, if you molasses. I'm going to add 1 cup of water.
Is that cold water?
It's room temperature.
Room temperature water.
And I'm going to put the pan into the machine.
That's all there is.
That's pretty much all there is. And I'm going to close the door, and in about 5 minutes, I'm going to check it just to make sure I don't have to add liquid or flour. Mm-hmm. You know, many manufacturers say, do not open the lid. Well, you have to open the lid. The machine only has a computer. It does not have a brain. A great secret for success working with the bread machine is after about 5 minutes of kneading, you want to check the consistency of the dough to see if you need additional flour or water. And I can see that this dough is a little sticky. However, look how beautifully the gluten has developed. The gluten is the protein in bread. Look at that stretchy. You've got a wonderful, wonderful dough.
Great.
So I'm going to close the lid and let it bake bread. So in this bread machine, we've made, oh my gosh, look at this wonderful dough. Isn't that terrific?
Really?
You know, the machine just works the gluten and makes it rise. Now we've got this great dough.
That looks lovely, I can see.
One of the things people say to me about the bread machine is, well, I like to handle the dough. I like to handle the dough too, so we could make a loaf of bread very easily out of the machine. So if you could give me a loaf pan, I'm going to use this dough.
Well, in my experience with the bread machine, I like it. I think the bread is much better if you take it out after. I leave it a second rise in there and take it out, and then I think the texture's better.
How about if we do a John Henry? We'll do the machine versus handmade.
Fine, good.
I'll make a loaf in the machine, and then we'll do a blind tasting. Mm-hmm. I'm going to butter the bread pan with a generous amount of butter. If you wish, you can use vegetable spray, but I prefer butter. You know, this is not about being a bakery, so this is probably not a perfect bakery loaf.
Well, do you have to form it, or you don't form it and you just dump it in?
I just dump it in. I've sort of made it loaf-shaped, as it were.
But you could form it if you wanted
to. Yes. I like actually taking advantage of what's left of the rise here.
Oh.
And you can now let this rise at room temperature. I'm going to cover it with a cloth. Or you can let it rise overnight in the refrigerator. I'm going to set this aside. And I've got some other dough
here. Does this have to do double in volume?
Double in bulk, exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Depending on the temperature in the kitchen, it could take 20 minutes, it could take an hour. Now, this dough can also be made into dinner rolls and all kinds of things. How about if we make some clover leaf rolls and some little twisty rolls? And these clover leaf rolls are very, very simple to make. I'm using this bench scraper, one of my favorite tools. And again, you can use nonstick vegetable spray, but we're going to use butter. So perhaps you could anoint the cups.
I'll do that when you form the rolls.
That would be wonderful.
Okay.
And the clover leaf is formed by cutting three little balls. You know, children love to do this. I just stick my finger up through there and form the ball. It doesn't have to be a perfect ball.
What you're doing is sort of pulling it around.
Pulling it around my finger,
mm-hmm.
forming the ball.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's it.
Putting it in closely.
Two, three.
Well, and that's all you do.
That's it. And
it's
again,
about
this is
that.
Not about making it look perfect or all the same, or, you know, they should be pretty much ballpark the same.
But you can do it as well as you can.
Exactly. As they rise, they'll grow together and become really pretty little dinner rolls. You can form these, and at that point, freeze them right in the pan.
Oh, well, that's a good idea.
Pull them out just before you're ready to bake them, and you can bake them frozen. Put the dough right in the oven. Take the dough out of the freezer. Put it into a cold oven. Turn the oven on, and as the oven preheats, your dough will defrost.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Now, those don't look very neat. But then you said that the yeast is forgiving and they'll look better.
Yes, as they rise, you'll be amazed at what happens. Things sort of come together. I'm going to use this egg glaze as
what
the
is,
finishing touch.
What
it's
is
got
that?
One egg mixed with about a half a cup of heavy cream.
Oh, that's interesting.
And it makes a beautiful, shiny, almost like mahogany.
I've never seen that kind of a glaze before.
My mother used to, when she made challah, she would always use an egg glaze. And we'll sprinkle it with some herbe de Provence.
Mm-hmm.
And because I've glazed these, I won't have to cover them. They will rise without developing a crust.
Well, that's nice.
We're going to let them raise about 20 minutes in a nice warm place.
Do they have to double in volume?
About double in bulk. So we can just let these rise right there. And now, I've got some extra dough, and I'll show you how to make these terrific little twisty knots. And they're going to bake on a baking sheet, so if I could...
I have one over here.
Right, and I'll take this dough out. Thank you. Since I have butter at hand, I'm going to quickly...
I love that sign that used to be on the buses in Paris. La cuisine au beurre est toujours meilleure, or cooking with butter is always better.
And I couldn't agree more.
Well, what's this
going to be? This is just a strip, and I'm going to tie it into a simple knot and make some dinner rolls.
Oh.
And again, you can form these and have them in the freezer, unbaked, and whip them out into your oven.
Let me see if I can do that.
Would you like to do it?
I would.
And while you do this, I will attempt to make a breadstick.
You better watch. Now, what did you do?
Just
like a regular knot.
Mm-hmm. That's it. Try it a little tighter. A little
tighter. Didn't stay in the knot.
You have to be assertive with the dough. That's it.
Like
perfect.
That. It's a real knot.
And just put it down there. Good. And you want to leave enough room between them because they're going to rise.
Uh-huh.
You don't want them rising into each other. But let's make one more in case we have four for lunch.
Well, this is wonderful that you can do this. You can do it freeze it on the baking sheet.
Just like on the baking sheet, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And one of the other options is to make a breadstick. And the way to do that is just take a long rope of dough, twist it out. Would you like to make one?
I better try one, too.
You make one?
That's fun.
You pull it out there. That's it. And isn't it, the dough is so flexible.
You know,
isn't that nice?
Well, as you say, that's that gluten that's making it hold
together. And that's why you use a good quality flour made with hard wheat. And that will give you the lovely stretchability, and that's what makes the bread rise.
Now, do these get glazed again?
These get glazed again. How about if we glaze these, and we'll add some poppy seeds to the breadsticks. We have some poppy seeds over there. You can sprinkle.
Yep.
And if you don't care for poppy seeds, you can leave them off. If you want sesame seeds, you can use them instead.
Yep.
Here are these.
Well, this is wonderful that all these right out just out of the same dough. I think that's great.
It's a very, very nice, flexible dough.
They know they just have to rise again.
They'll rise again probably for 20 to 30 minutes again until they're double in bulk. Well, how's our bread doing?
Look at that!
I'd say that's double in bulk,
would
you?
Isn't that
a lovely loaf of bread? Now, there's a surefire way to tell whether your bread has risen all the way, and that's by poking it gently. And see how the poke mark comes right back?
Yes, it does.
So you don't want to do it too aggressively.
No. That's splendid, isn't it?
I'm going to bake it at 450 degrees. My oven is preheated, and for about 15 minutes at 450, I'm going to turn the oven down to 375 for another 30 minutes.
Until it's done.
Until it's done.
There we are.
There we go, right in the center rack.
Hey, what happened to your bread pan?
You may notice that it's missing. During the last 10 minutes of the baking time, I like to remove the bread to let it brown all around.
Yeah.
I'm going to show you a surefire way to tell. No more of that thumping business, which confused me. We're going to take the bread's internal temperature. And 200 degrees.
200 degrees.
Now, this is one way of doing it. You can use an instant read thermometer if you wish. And this is a good way. You can certainly do it this way. And there it is.
Yeah, it takes a little while to get up there. There we
are. Excellent. It is done. I'm going to remove it to a cooling rack. Close the oven. Thank you. This is a beautiful loaf of bread. And our bread machine loaf is done as well. I like to bypass that cooling cycle because I find that it makes the bread soggy. So as soon as the bread is baked, I like to remove it. We're going to take out this kneading pin. You can see that? There.
Yeah.
And you want to be careful not to drop it. Oh, careful, it's hot, hot. Don't burn yourself. You want to be careful not to drop it in the disposal or in the garbage. I found out the hard way how difficult it is to replace. And
so here's this look at it all.
Marvelous loaf. Look at that.
That's
where the kneading blade, the mark from the kneading blade that's in the back
of the
machine.
Well, it doesn't make a pretty loaf, does it?
I think it makes a pretty loaf. There, look at that. It's a different kind of loaf.
Now,
you know, the smell is really intoxicating, and I think that the urge is to eat it right away, but it's a really good idea to let the bread cool off. It's still baking internally, and if you take a knife and slice it, it gets sort of gummy. We've got the rolls that we baked at 450 degrees for about 12 to 15 minutes until they're nice and brown. Those we can eat right out of the oven. Aren't they nice?
Should we open one up?
Sure.
Is that still slightly warm? That's nice. That's good.
Good?
So we'll have to let these wait,
15 minutes.
Or even longer, or what?
I like warm bread.
All right. Well, we'll wait 20 minutes.
All right. That's a good compromise. A great debate about these strange shaped loaves. Do you cut them from the top? Do you cut them from the side? This is the way I like to cut them.
Right.
How about if we check
middle.
The texture of this against, this is the one that was baked in the machine.
Yeah.
And this is the one that was baked
kneaded in the machine.
Kneaded,
and risen.
Well, what do you think?
Let's cut a little piece off
all
and
right.
taste it.
Okay.
It's a very thick piece.
It's a very thick piece. One of the keys, actually, to cutting bread nicely is to use a very sharp, serrated knife. And this is one of my favorites. So what you're tasting is the one that was baked in the oven.
Mm-hmm.
And here is the bread machine. It's got a lovely crumb.
Oh, that's pretty
good.
So good
you don't even need butter, huh?
I think it's the same, but I've not had the same experience.
Well, you're just going to have me in your kitchen more.
I think
hang
maybe
out with
that's
me.
It. Well, Laura, this is fascinating. I think it's a wonderful machine. I think you've got the right spirit of you're the boss of the machine. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Julia.
This is a wonderful, gutsy, spicy bread, and it's made out of all kinds of things. Laura's secret, and you're going to tell us what's in it and
secret,
how you make it.
Right, secret no more. What I did in this bread is I combined legumes in the form of refried beans and some really good whole wheat flour creates a complete protein.
Well, let's make it.
All right. We're going to start with yeast. We're going to use a tablespoon of yeast, and again, it's that instant dissolving
milk.
Yeast, yes, and we have some cornmeal. You can use just yellow or white. It's a half a cup. It gives that wonderful crunchy and sweet texture to the. We've got 3 tablespoons of non-fat dry milk, and I add this for 2 reasons. One, to give a nice stretching ability to the bread, and for a calcium boost as well. And we're going to add some chili powder, 2 teaspoons.
Is this triple strength?
I hope this is mild. I really like to give my guests not a tremendous surprise, or my eaters, as it were. Teaspoon and a half of salt.
Do you use any special salt, like kosher or?
I don't use kosher salt or coarse salt in the bread machine because I'm afraid it might scratch the Teflon.
I
try to be
that's
careful
a good
about
idea,
it.
Yes.
You know, if you scratch the Teflon, it makes it awfully difficult to get the bread out. I'm going to use some white wheat flour in this recipe. You can certainly use all white or even all white wheat, but we're going to have a combination. So it's 1 cup of the white wheat, or whole wheat if you wish.
It's another whole wheat is white.
Whole wheat is
white wheat with
white wheat is a lighter kind of whole wheat flour.
Oh.
So it's 2 of white and 1 of white wheat. So those are the dry ingredients. Moving right along to the wet ingredients, we've got these refried beans, and they come in a can, and I like to use the vegetarian refried beans. There are lots of different kinds on the market, non-vegetarian, spicy, not spicy, and I'm eyeballing about 1 cup. This is a 10-ounce can, but you know, more or less, is not going to make
it come in a paste like that. That's interesting.
And it smells really, really good. And we've got this, I brought this back from Santa Fe. This is Taos red chili honey, but
red chili honey.
You can, isn't that a beautiful color? You can use any kind of honey you wish. If you can't find red chili honey, that's not a problem. We have 1/4 cup of oil, and I've got this wonderful mild chili oil.
Gosh.
And we've got an egg.
One egg.
And a cup of water. And what I'm going to do is make this loaf of bread. Right in the bread machine, I'm going to put the pan in there and press start. And again, after about a few minutes, I'm going to look in, see how things are going. But you know, the fact is, you don't have to make the loaf of bread. You have some choices. And if you use the machine just in the dough cycle, you can make something called quitza.
And what's that?
It is a cross between pizza and quiche. And here is the dough. I'm going to make it in this springform pan with slope sides.
Oh.
We're calling it a slope-sided springform pan.
But you could use, that doesn't have to be.
Oh, no, you can use a springform pan
or. It's just pretty.
You can also just make this into a flat pizza and roll it out and put it on a baking dish. And I'm going to get my rolling pin here, and I'm going to roll this out.
You always use a marble pin.
Well, I like to do it because it's got heft.
Yeah.
And it really helps.
Mm-hmm.
And it's nice and cold. Now,
the dough is a very pretty color.
Isn't it a pretty color? And it's also,
pinch
again,
taste
very...
It.
Now, at this point, I could bake it on a pizza stone if mm-hmm. I wished, but now I'm going to line this pan with the dough.
But just tasting it, it doesn't have... It isn't overly spicy.
No. And again, this is not about being... having it perfect. I'm not good at that.
Rustic,
indeed. So there is my, and I've got a little dough left over. I can just patch it up there. So to finish this off, I've got some softened cream cheese here.
Oh, and I'm going to plain old usual
cream cheese. Yes,
mm-hmm.
Nice and soft, so it's easily spreadable. I'm going to put this on the bottom. And this is some jarred salsa, and it's chunky salsa. And what I did was put it into a sieve and allow some of the liquid to drain out.
Uh-huh.
And that prevents...
This is just store-bought salsa.
It is, and you could certainly make your own
mm-hmm.
if you have a favorite recipe. I'm going to spread it out here. And then I'm going to top the whole thing with some grated cheddar cheese. It's about a cup.
Mm, I can smell that salt.
Is that nice?
Yes, very fresh, nice.
So we'll just let it rise until it's double in bulk, about 20 to 40 minutes, and then we're going to be baking it.
At 475 for 20 to 25 minutes.
So we have achieved quitza.
That's beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful. It's kind of like a deep dish pizza,
but
much more pizzazz.
And
that looks lovely.
You can have this hot out of the oven. It's
Look at that.
I love it when everything melts together. Isn't that great?
Isn't that beautiful?
Wow. All right. Here's a piece for you. And I'll cut a piece.
Mm.
Let me know what you think. Oh, boy.
Mm. That's wonderful. It's not too spicy, but you've got all the taste of things in it.
Exactly.
That's delicious.
If you want to make it spicy, you can just put some hot sauce on top.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I think the combination of cheeses is so good. Isn't that good?
That's not shabby. Mm-hmm. I'm always amazed, you know? It's just great.
Think of all that we've done.
I think it's very exciting for the home cook, the home baker, to know mm-hmm. that this can be done quite easily.
And all thanks to you, Laura. Thank you so much for coming, dear.
It was just my great pleasure.
Because I've always wanted to know what you could do with this machine, and I'm very grateful to
you. Now, are you going to keep your machine on your counter now?
Yes, I sure am.
Good.
Bon appétit!